Good morning, everyone. Looking at how to prevent heat illness this week. One of the things that we do at our school is our athletic trainer follows the wet bulb reading. We have a group text message for all the head coaches, especially the ones that are outside, and we follow what the guidelines are for that with GHSA. So depending on the wet bulb reading, depends on how long we can go for our practice and how many water breaks we need during that time. With softball, of course, it's during the summertime in August, which is pretty hot. So we usually have to break our practices down and extend our water breaks a good amount to make sure that we don't have any problems with kids suffering from heat illnesses. Another thing we do at our practices, we have water and ice available on site. So we have our kids fill up the water cooler with water and ice. That way they don't have any reason not to stay hydrated. Our athletic trainer also, since we're a smaller program with softball, gives each of our softball players a Powerade water bottle since we're sponsored by Coke. So each one of them has a water bottle that they keep in their locker and bring to practice with them every day. We also have AC for controlled indoor facilities to make sure that there's not any heat illnesses going on inside. Have I experienced any heat illnesses? Yes, I have. We actually had an athlete last year who ran cross country and also played softball. So in the mornings, a lot of times she would go and run her cross country route for practice, and then she would come to softball. She did do a pretty good job of staying hydrated. I don't believe she did a good job of eating in between those and making sure she's getting her nutrition in between, especially for how many calories she was burning. She was one of our harder working athletes for a softball team, so she's going hard all the time at practice, and one day she just couldn't get her body right. She started cramping up. We got her inside in our locker room, which has AC. Later on the couch in there, trying to control her breathing a little bit, called our AT down to come do, and he checked her vitals frequently. We got ice for her, put ice around her neck, in her armpits, and then in her groin area, trying to hit those major arteries to help that blood cool off that's circulating through her body. She was experiencing a lot of cramps. It took us a good while to get her back to normal, where she wasn't experiencing that heavy breathing and getting those cramps going on in her body. So that was kind of a scary situation. It wasn't far enough to where we had to call EMS, but our athletic trainer was monitoring her vital signs, making sure that it didn't get any worse and go into a heat stroke, so we didn't have to get her out of here. Heat cramps, we just kind of allow them to cool off with water breaks, resting, maybe coming inside for a breather in the air conditioning, kind of cool off a little bit. Heat exhaustion, this is what our athlete experienced. We put them in a cool room, put her in a cool room, and just kind of like let her body cool back down to make sure it didn't get any worse. And for a heat stroke, this is where you probably need to call medical services and get them involved. We would call our athletic trainer as well, get them both down here, and then move further with what we need to get done to try and help them get back to normal from those heat injuries. We have a emergency action plan at our school. Each facility at our school has one that is separate to that location on campus. So ours includes our athletic trainer if he's here during a game. Usually it would be me if it's just practice, but we have in our list of things who to call and make sure that they're made available or made aware of the situation going on. Our assistant coaches will go up because our softball field is kind of hidden down on our campus. So we have our assistant coach go up and kind of meet the paramedics as they come down so they know where to go and don't get lost on our campus and can get here as fast as possible. That's probably the hardest thing for our emergency action plan, is just making sure that the fire department and the paramedics know where our location is on the school campus. We are pretty lucky that within 5 miles, we have a fire department. So they're at our school quite frequently, and they know where the layout of our campus and stuff like that. So it's not like they're coming in blind, not knowing where to go. So that helps out a lot with our campus. I have not had any experience with sickle cell traits in any athletes. This is something that it's not necessarily foreign to me, but we just haven't had any experience with it at the schools I've been at. Something that I already knew about sickle cell is that I had belief that it was in mostly African Americans, that it was a trait carried in mostly African American, but it's not always. There can be some circumstances where it's not necessarily an African American. And after reading, it looks like it comes from those countries that malaria is present. So also the Caribbeans and those island countries, it can be prevalent down there as well. One thing that I didn't realize with sickle cell, just not having dealt with it that much, is that those red blood cells change shapes into a crescent. So that's the reason that they're not carrying that oxygen and helping supply the body with the oxygen that they need. Another thing that I didn't realize is that if they stay hydrated, it will help kind of delay those sickle cells traits coming in while they're exercising. So making sure that the athlete stays hydrated is an important thing during that. And then also the last thing that I thought was surprising with sickle cell is that the military, with their sickle cell, or the introduction of sickle cell into the military, their recruits were 30 times more likely to die during basic training if they had sickle cell. So that's a pretty high number of, or a pretty high percentage of people passing away during basic training. So I think that's an important reason why, if you do know you have sickle cell, it's good to be cautious of it and making sure that you're paying attention to those signs, but also making sure that the instructor or coach or whatever is also made aware that you have sickle cell so they can pay attention to those symptoms as well.